Welcome, Zebra sports fans, to sectional finals here down at Peru High School at Bingle Memorial Stadium. We are going to be broadcasting for you this evening the Rochester Zebras against the Peru Tigers in the sectional championship for this evening. 6 o'clock start for us. They are marching our guys out here for introductions, and we'll have those for you here momentarily.
The weather currently for game time is 57 degrees.
Rochester comes in with a record of 14-2. It's the first time they've completed a regular season without a tie as we come into tonight's contest. And Peru enters the contest at 12-5-1. So should be a very good matchup this evening. This is the first time these two have met throughout this year. They usually have a regular season game scheduled, but this year that game was canceled due to weather issues and field conditions. So we will not have a previous matchup like we've had before coming to the sectionals. But this is Rochester's fourth time in the sectional championship. They are currently 0-3 in there. The last 2 years they've been to the sectional championship and have come up empty-handed. 1-0 losses to the hands of the Peru Tigers. So Peru in the last 2 years in the sectional has had the Zebras number, defeating those guys 1-0. So this matchup this evening should be a really good matchup for high school soccer teams, one with a building tradition with the Rochester Zebras and with the Peru Tigers coming off, you know, back-to-back, looking for a three-peat in a sectional championship. So tonight's matchup between these two teams should be a very closely contested and very intriguing matchup as we go through the night.
Yeah, I would really expect to see an aggressive, well defensively played match tonight. After talking with the kids in the hallway, they're ready for this game. They're ready for some vindication and ready to get Plymouth this time around. So let's hope that third time's a charm and they've had enough time to prepare this week and get ready for the finals tonight.
Well, yeah, Coach Brown and I just down the hallway from each other and we talk and you know, they've used the season to prepare themselves and to get ready to go for tonight's matchup. Face the south end zone. We'll be right back. We're getting ready for our national anthem. Greatest country in the world. All right, Zebra fans, there was our national anthem. We were just moments away from kickoff this evening. So interrupted right there in the middle of conversation. So, but we'll be wrapping up and we're ready to roll here in just a moment. Rochester will be in the home whites this evening.
No.
Goofed
Rochester
up.
Is in
Rochester
black
is in black. They switched
tonight.
Fields on us coming in. So, yeah, Rochester is in the traveling black. Peru will be in the home whites this evening. So, officials are ready to go. They've been stretched out. Hopefully, they're ready to run from flag to flag. And we'll have a clean officiated game this evening.
Yeah.
Okay, Peru will be kicking off. Kickoff's just a formality of ball possession here. Just a quick glance at the field and the lineups here. Rochester is really pulled high in their back four, running a 4-4-2. Peru is also in a 4-4-2, so similar styles of matchups this evening for both teams. It's going to come down to, really, as you look at it statistically as we're coming in the game, is, you know, Zach DuBois on the front side right there has the ball.
As we expected, some aggressive play right from the get-go.
Yep.
We've got charged emotions here tonight, and we're ready for a high-intensity game.
All right. This is going to be the third time that these two have matched up in the sectional championship in the last 3 years. So it's Rochester's wanting to break through and get their first title and in program history. And Peru's wanting to add to the previous two that they've already completed and won. So it's going to be an interesting matchup as far as the midfield goes, and if Killian Bailey can control that, he does such a nice job of ball control and you know, directing everybody from that center mid position, then we're going to have a lot of midfield play and control. That's what, you know, Coach Brown's looking for, is that midfield control, you know, that middle third of the field from from 30 to 30 yard marker out there, which is not really, you know, marked, but that's what they're going to look for. If Killian can control that, which he's done a fabulous job throughout the year, you know, being 14 and 2, that's really the strength of your defense there, is what you're going to be looking at. And if Peru center mids can establish that, or their presence and control, that's going to really what's going to decide this game. It's just that center mid position.
I missed that call there, but we've got... What is that, a direct
kick? It was a direct kick. There was a foul. Yeah, Zach Du Bois and a Peru Tiger defender was pursuing the ball over there, and they said that the Peru player raised the arm and committed a foul. So usually, the sectional championship, of anything, the officials will call things pretty tight at first just to set the tone, and then as the game progresses, we'll... Okay, yep, just like that there. Caleb was just a little aggressive on the pursuit from behind, got a little bit more than just the ball there, and so we're looking at a direct kick from about 30 yards out. Dangerous ball right here. If you notice, the fullbacks are pulled up to the edge of the 18 to give Taylor that cushion for a ball.
Mm, right there, right there.
Yes, oh. Peru Tiger!
Goal for Peru, the three-minute mark already into the game. That's what we talked about, pulling up in there off of there, and Taylor held his line a little bit too long and misplayed that ball coming up. So we'll get a time on it here in just a second. Looked like the ball play was played off of Peru player's arm into his feet, which we talked about previously, that that's the case. It should be handball, but it's the angle of the officials. If the one official from this line judge go stops at midfield, the center official should take stuff up the middle, and then the line judge on the other side can make those calls, just needs to raise his flag. So no one saw the foul. So no foul, no harm.
Was number 7. Braxton Campbell, I believe, with the goal there.
At the 2:50. Oh, I got to look at my time here.
You're better at translating that time than I am. I
have 2:26.
Making that backwards.
Yeah.
Counting up.
2:26 mark. Was the first goal. So Rochester trails Peru 1-0 early in the championship game. So this should change emotions and the tone of play right now. You're going to see probably Rochester really pushing up, trying to get that equalizer early, but the kids have got to remember there's a lot of time left in the game to settle themselves and, you know, get some good opportunities. Stick to the game plan. You know, Coach Brown's talked about what they want to do and how they want to attack. You know, they're a control up the middle on the ground. Ball's just a little outside of the box there. They're going to want to attack up the middle. You don't get those pursuits, those balls to the ground, overload the backside. And a lot of teams will make a run through the space. Won't stand in the space. They move to the soccer ball coming into the box area. So that's why you'll see them overload on one side opposite the ball and will come through the box. They'll try to run on and flick it. So it's not as easy to mark and guard.
You know, we saw a lot of nerves, I thought, the other night against Caston. And I don't know that I'm seeing as much of that nerviness and nervous energy out there tonight.
Yeah.
But definitely not a settled team right now.
No, well, you know, that free kick back there at the 30 is just a funny time to go. And what's concerning as you watch, you know, Campbell was up front. He had a defender, but he wasn't marked tightly on that through ball. And you know, everybody on the front side, on the back side, those fullbacks have got to mark up. They've got to play ball side of their man, and they got to get any dangerous ball that comes through there. So,
and to Peru's credit tonight, they're really quick. They're getting to marks quickly and beating out the defenders.
Well, I think that what you're seeing is you've got quicker strikers up front for Peru than what we had against Caston the other night. And you know, the fullbacks are off a step. They're not quite on that first step, and they're not used to the speed. And that's what it's so dangerous, you know, starting a game and misplaying a ball up there, that you've got to respect them. You've got to mark those guys up early and often. Big throw. What I'm surprised is that Taylor Medina was a little still a little passive coming off his line to get to that ball. I think he mistimed it, misjudged it, and I mean that's not typical of Taylor. He's really solid back between the pipes, and you more than likely won't see him make that mistake again. He's only averaging 0.5. Okay, we've got a PK coming right out and push in the back. I don't know who they called that on because there wasn't a whole lot of action going on down there in the box. It looked more incidental to me than it was anything, but like I said, that's why the guys get paid to do what they do. So, number one for Peru is going to take the PK kick. Taylor can move. He just can't come off the line. He can shuffle back and forth. He can't leave the line until the ball has struck, so he can bounce back and forth on that line. He just can't come off of it. So this is a big stop for the Zebras right here. And goal number two for Peru. They are on the board early. The 5:18 mark. First 5 minutes of the ball game here. Peru has struck twice early on. So now the Zebras have got themselves into a sizable hole to get caught up here.
But it is early. We've got lots of ball game left. So hopefully they don't let the fact that they're down 2-0 now get in their heads too badly, because they have plenty of time to get back in the game.
Yes, there's plenty of time on the clock to get that to happen. But I think what you're seeing is Peru's a little, or not Peru, Rochester's a little shell shocked with how quickly they've come out and they've scored twice on them. Their goals against average for the year is only about is about 1.2 per contest, and they've already given up two in the first 5 minutes and 18 seconds of this contest. So no need to panic. Still.
No.
Tons of time in this first half. They just got to collect themselves. They need a couple good balls here, really possess and put some pressure on Peru.
And it looks like we had a Rochester substitution. We've got AJ Knotts in coming in for Christian Copeland.
Yep, just another center mid coming in through there to help Killian up there. I think he's got his hands full with marking up those defenders, but they're going to have to get control in the back. I don't know who the foul was on, the misplayed ball. That's the Taylor Medina that we normally see, is him coming off his line and cleaning up that. He's really quick coming off there, and if he doesn't come off his line and clean that up, we're probably looking at a 3-0 goal advantage right now for Peru. But that's just his trademark. He's always very aggressive back in the goal, creating things out there. And ball goes across. Zach Du Bois. Just misplayed it
there.
You know, when we talk about that first PK, or not first PK, that first foul we had when they pulled up on the 18. Those guys are not marking. We're not marking closely in the back, and that ball should not have gotten through into that backside defender. He should have been marked up, and we should have been the first one to it. So those 50-50 balls, we are not winning those 50-50 balls as they're played through the space in the area. That's what's concerning, I think, to Coach Brown right now, is we're not winning those 50-50 balls to, gain those advantage. Those 50-50 balls either played into space or in the air. We've got to control those. We've got to win those and make some things happen. Number 16, Deshaun Whitfield exits the game here. I think they're having a little conversation about back marking and who's there. So another misplayed ball. We're going to have to get there quick. Zach Agnew closed down the space. Good pressure. Good defense there on closing it down. Okay. Nope, no call there. It was played on advantage.
Oh, offsides.
Nice.
See, and that goes back to, that.
But the center official, offsides. Is he calling it? Yes, he just called the offsides.
No, he called from the flag. But as the ball's played, that's what you always have to look at, is when the ball's played, was Jonathan even with that last defender, or did he leave early?
He left a little early.
And she's shaking her head.
He had a good stride ahead of the defenders there.
Yeah. So, I mean, I had a post in front of my view, so. Over it. Come on, Taylor. There we go. That's it. So he's just a little hesitant. I know that last year in the sectional finals, she ran through a guy, was pretty aggressively, was called for a foul, and Rochester ended up losing 1-0. And I know that talking with Taylor, he feels a little bit of responsibility for it. So I think he's trying to be careful to not to be too aggressive and have another one of those. But he can't now. They're down 2-0. He's going to have to go back to being very aggressive back there and just keeping it clean. And he can play that way. He's just a very emotional kid, a very fiery kid, just has to collect that. And he's done a good job of keeping himself in check this year, and tonight's no different than any other, but it's uncharacteristic for him to give up 2 goals in a game, and I can't remember the last time that's happened. You know, 2 Taylor this year in the season. Comes Killian. All right, here's a pursuit. Okay, good pressure. Good pressure by him coming back. The outside half's got to contain. There we go. So that's good ball pressure. Way to pursue that. Those are the balls we weren't winning early on, those 50-50 balls. Okay, now we've talked about that transition, you know, in a game of, you know, going from defense and then to offense. You know, look at the back four, you know, look at our fullbacks. Are they transitioning? Are our midfielders, are they moving to the spots and overlapping? Where are they in space? We're strung out. We're not, 10 to 15 yards apart. That's what we've got to get back into, getting our shape and our uniform team continuity, you know, back into some consistency.
I don't feel like we're communicating as well tonight as we were the other night as well. Not hearing the balls being called out when they're passing, and a lot of unsettled balls up in the air again. So maybe nerves are playing in a little more than I had thought originally.
I think so. And then, you know, giving up 2 quick goals, I think also has stunned them. You know, they weren't, I don't think, figuring on giving up those 2 goals that, you know, early to Peru. But, I mean, Peru capitalized on two possessions that they had, you know, point blank. They're 2-for-2 in that inside the 18. So it's just a matter of composure. You know, we've got a lot of veteran guys out there in the field that have played, been in this position before. And, you know, it's just got it's composure.
Got a flag on the sideline over there. Thought it was going to be a handball, but it looks like it's going to be a penalty.
Okay, yep. He had the handball on Jonathan Baker. Was going to the ground, reached out, handball came off his hands. It's a direct kick. That's the motion of the official. So he just mispointed. Happens. I've heard from time to time.
You mean the officials aren't always right?
I've never heard that. I've never heard that. No,
nope,
I'm not gonna talk about that. That's just the.
It's the human element.
It's the human element. That's the thing that you can't take out of, you know, any kind of contest. Is, you know, there's. We've got some discussion here with the official and.
You got kicked in the ball. Direct kick in the face.
With the official and the Rochester player. Got to get a number. Oh, on the Peru kid. Sorry.
Yeah. We're
in black tonight. Threw me off again. So. Okay, now we've got our outside backs have pushed up, way up, looking for that equalizer, leaving Killian alone. In that center mid all by himself to possess. He's really working hard out there already in this first 13 minutes of this ball game. So they're going to have to regulate. They're going to have to get him some help so they don't wear him out too early. We got a corner kick for the Zebras.
See if we can capitalize on this one.
Caleb undertaking it. Ball played in low. Needs to get a little off on that to get that up there to give us a chance to get ahead on it, knock it in there.
Got some Zebra substitutions again.
Noah Roberts and Christian Copeland in for the Zebras.
Looks like we have Christian Copeland and Noah Roberts coming in.
And it goes back to, you know, Coach Brown's, you know, substitution patterns. He's run the same patterns as he ran the other night against Caston, you know, giving guys fresh legs. I would imagine that Killian may be taking that next substitution. But I tell you what, being down 2-0, you've got to keep him in there. He is the guy that runs the show for us right there in the middle of the field, distributing the ball, moving guys around with it. You've got to keep him fresh. I mean, you're 16 games in the season. I mean, he should have his legs. This is a game you don't want to come out of, as being a center mid where you control everything. You want to run forever. And the way the temperature is, nice and cool tonight, sun setting, you're going to want to, just stay and play forever.
Yeah, and we've got a little bit of cloud cover that's kind of taken the shadow element out of play tonight, unlike the other night. We had a lot of shadowing across the field.
Yeah.
So that's good, too, from the player's point of view, is they're not distracted or the depth perception isn't affected as much.
Yeah, foul on Peru here on a little trip from behind. Be a direct kick for the Zebras. Just played it in quick. He was out about 45 yards. Good dangerous ball in the box by Denville Mason. Peru keeper comes out. Does a good job of cleaning up that dangerous ball. Keep that ball on the ground. Okay, it was played back to Taylor like we talked the other night. When it's played back by your own teammate to the keeper with your feet, he cannot pick it up. He becomes a field player out there on the field. If it's played back to Taylor off of a header, somebody flicks it back to him, he's allowed to possess the ball and play just as he would as a keeper. So that's something to keep in mind is, why doesn't he pick it up? And people ask me, why doesn't he pick the ball up when it comes back to him like that? He can't. How they've moved the rules and stuff with it. And he called that off. You could hear him call that one off, which that's the Medina that we know.
Yep.
Back there, cleaning up. That's a dangerous ball.
We had some good communication that time.
Yeah,
you could hear Taylor calling that out. And
it's like you talked about, Allison. That's something that we haven't had early on. And I think it's nerves and it's jitter. And, these guys feel some pressure. They want to be successful. They want to get a sectional championship. And they've got a hole to dig out of right now. So, but it's still very achievable. They scored 6 the other night against Caston. So that these guys can score. They just got to put together some good combinations of guys overlapping. So
some frustration over there by Coach Brown on the sidelines.
We're just off a step. I mean, yes. we're not possessing the ball cleanly. We're not trapping it with it. Zach took off with that ball, was pushing it, pushed it wide to the left over there. I was looking on this backside to see if our overlapping halfback was doing anything, which was Jace Bixler, and he was running late into the space. If, he's got to take off and time his run so he can have a ball played, and if it's played back across, he's there to help clean up anything that's wide. So, the corner kick for the Zebras, that's the second one of the half, so we are getting a lot of penetration the second half deep into the Peru zone. We just got to put one in here. Tyler Gilbert had a nice little play and sequence there, keeping the ball down here and keeping the pressure on Peru. Still in pursuit. Good defensive pressure. And that forced a turnover. And that's what, Coach Brown's looking for, is that pressure on the ball, making him, hand the ball cleanly. That Coach Brown has moved Chris Copeland a little bit more up. He's been a lot more aggressive in the backfield than he was the other day.
Here we go.
Jace Bixler with a shot on goal, deflected
just
and saved.
Deflected.
Nice shot by Jace Bixler on goal. Jace, nice low, dangerous
Bixler
ball.
Strong drive, strong shot at goal. But once again, Paul Honey, you're right there for the great deflection and the stop.
You see different strategies on the corner kicks. What do you think the thought is behind those low kicks on those corner kicks?
Well, I mean, there's a couple different ideas on those. Most of the time, you'll see guys want the ball up, and I think we've just miskicked them. We haven't gotten enough foot underneath those in the first half. But a lot of times, you'll see people will play it short, will come off the flag, they'll play it just outside the 18, and then they'll get a chip shot in there just to change the angle. Good dangerous ball, just plays wide. Jace Bixler off of there.
Goal kick. Jason's doing a really, really nice job of being there at the right time to get those little incidental balls.
Yeah, and we talked about that just before that. He was late on his run, and ever since, you know, that one last possession here just a couple minutes ago, he's been right on top of things, overlapping correctly, filling those lanes, keeping himself wide, just misplayed it. If he's just a step forward there, he probably gets a nice, clean look on it. Great head ball by Killian back into the center of the field. I think Coach Brown's, you know, thought process behind it, Copeland and Du Bois up in the center, gives them a lot of speed and a lot of quickness and a lot of athleticism up there to try and get that equalizer. I think, you know, what we've seen is we've seen Rochester settle in, control the ball. I think Killian's doing a superb job of controlling that midfield. He's possessing it, knocks the ball to his feet, and then he's taking a moment to turn and pass. And I'm sure that Peru's coaches are wanting those guys to turn and get after him a little bit more and pressure him. But right now, he is controlling that center midfield portion of the field really, really well. Looks very composed, very strong, you know, on the field.
We've got some Rochester substitutions again with Deshaun Whitfield and I believe Cameron Gast coming into the game.
Okay, and Cameron Gast could be that little offensive spark he scored the other night against Caston, you know, for him. So that could be that extra little scoring threat, but anybody they have out there on the field right now is capable of putting one in nice and cleanly. Yeah. Taylor surveying the field, decided which way that he wants to go with this ball. Played out. I think you've seen that. If you watch the linesman running the field here with the official that's on our side of the field here, just in front of the box, is doing a really good job of staying with that back defender. The other night, the guy in the casting game, I didn't feel, did a great job of keeping himself in the right position to make that call.
20 minutes halfway through the first half play.
Throw in for the Tigers.
Light throw in.
Kicked off of Zach Agnew.
Right inside there.
Good pressure. That's what we weren't seeing in the first 18 minutes. Whitfield was pursuing that ball, jabbing, and then getting burned, and then wasn't able to, you know, regain his footing to get back to it. There, he did a great job of closing down, letting the offensive player kind of make a mistake, and then taking the ball out. So, composure. The guys have regained their composure. They just need one here, need a goal before half, make it 2-1, and they'll be in great shape in the second half. We got to move to the ball. Move to the ball.
Another zebra substitution. We have Jace Bixler exiting and Caleb Hunter coming back in.
Anyway, as you watch, these guys, as they play, the offensive player, if you watch their runs, Cameron Gast, great job. Good shot on goal.
Nice shot there.
That's getting that extra guy with it by Zach Du Bois. Great save.
Zach Du Bois.
Cameron's right there hanging around just in case he can get his foot on that ball and get it past the goalie.
You know, that's kind of the idea with the 4-4-2 in high school soccer is you give, you know, a guy takes a good clean shot, that extra guy's got to run to the keeper. That's kind of his responsibility is when that shot's fired and the ball goes towards the keeper. If he runs, anything that deflects off is usually right there to play and clean in. So Cameron's got to run a little bit quicker to the keeper. And
but it was a good idea, though, that he hung back, because then we ended up with the corner kick out of it because it went off the Peru defender.
And that there, when Caleb was able to get that ball a little bit of air underneath that ball, you know, and get a good dangerous ball in there. Good cross across the middle, just misplaced by Noah Roberts. Ball's going to be played out wide and go to Zebra. Zebra throw in. 17:50 left in the first half. Rochester is trailing 2-0. Ever since that second goal, with about 34 minutes left, we have really controlled tempo and the pace, just haven't been unable to get that goal.
Again, I feel like we're just half a step behind on those throw-ins.
Yep. We're not moving well on the offensive end to the ball on those inbound throws. So we'll see if Noah's got a good throw-in. Let's see if his throw-ins here on this narrow field will get it probably close to the six in the middle, and that's where you want it to go. You got to move, get into position, guys. Good dangerous ball in the middle. Good chip, dangerous ball right into the keeper. Good save, good dangerous ball.
Tyler Gilbert trying to volley it in, but Paul Honeyager there for the stop.
Taylor Medina with the save again.
Taylor Medina with another save. White ball.
Looks like what Micah has kind of dropped back from a really a flat back forward to a sweeper stopper mode. He's kind of playing the stopper back there, just kind of cleaning things up, kind of pulled himself even. But with his quickness, he should be able to cover a lot of ground back there. Tyler Gilbert, I think, has played a phenomenal first half in the back there, coming in and filling those gaps and being that guy that pushes up and chips some balls in there and keeps the ball down here for our strikers up front, keeping that ball alive. So what you got to also watch, too, is the ball can touch the line. It can roll down the line. The ball has to be completely over the line in order for it to be out, to be counted out of bounds. So, but for it to count as a goal, the ball just has to break that ball. It doesn't have to be completely in the plane of the goal and be in there. So to be out of bounds, a player can run out of bounds, play that ball back in as long as the ball, that's the important part, is still in bounds. And a hard foul up front. It's good sportsmanship. Yeah, you like to see that. You know, it's just a good aggressive play, going for it. Comes over and you know, checks with Chris to make sure that, you know, no, didn't really mean to hit him that hard.
Probably got the wind knocked out of him a little bit. That's pretty hard
legs,
to get together.
Legs swept out from underneath him. I mean, it's just aggressive play.
Right.
It wasn't anything malicious where he was trying to hurt anybody. It was just coming in there, being aggressive, trying to play the ball, doing his job. And you like to see that sportsmanship-wise, coming in there and hey, checking with him and, hey, said, sorry about that. Didn't mean to play that hard. Hope you're okay. You know, it's just a good mark.
Zach Du Bois.
Okay, Killian's had a breather. He's back in now, subbing in. So 10 yards off the ball. That's where it's got to be played on a foul. Ball's touched, just indirect. Plays it wide for Caleb Hunter.
Oh, good thought.
Ball Honey here with the stop.
So that was an indirect kick.
Yep, indirect kick. Had his hand straight up in the air. That's always an indication of what your kick is. So straight up's indirect. If it's forward, out in front, it's direct kick.
What's this called?
I don't know what we've got.
What do we have?
Subs 3 and 21.
Ball's played in. Ball's played in. Usually play on. You don't stop it, then bring it back.
Zebra substitutions.
Interesting.
Jonathan Baker and Aaron Orr coming in for the Zebras.
Yeah, it's ball played in like that, and it's live, and it's going. You don't stop playing, come back in on a throw-in for substitutions. Good throw.
Good throw
in the middle.
In there.
Just flicked over the head. No shot there. No shot. And then people ask, you know, what's a shot on goal? What's not a shot on goal? You know, shot on goal is a ball that if the keeper does not stop it, it's going to go in, you know, into the goal.
Oh, yeah. I thought maybe that could be a handball there. Incidental contact.
Yeah, but he gained an advantage. The ball drops to his feet where it's playable, and that's where it's considered. Now, okay, do we mark up? Okay, we're going with 7. We've got 7 this time. Okay, Noah had the backside. Much better job of covering. Okay. I always tell our guys, you know, as you're clearing the ball out of the 18, clear it to the sideline. Never clear it to the middle, because that's usually where your better offensive strikers are at and where everybody's kind of congregating around, is in the center of the field. So, you know.
We've got Peru substitutions this time. We've got number 10, Simmons, and number 15, Tahan. One of the few Peru substitutions we've had so far.
Yeah, Peru has not subbed in and out very much. Good pressure by both the Whitfields, but it's a good possession here. Now it's transition. It's a quick transition. We should have our backside guys overlapping, taking off to fill these gaps. We get this backside. Noah needs to be taken off and filling the space right here, moving a whole lot quicker up the field. I know Coach Brown, that's that transition. You know, mark of a good team will transition from defense to offense within a matter of seconds, you know, on the backside of it. And that's something that we should do a better job of here as we move from out. It's a sprint. You know, soccer is 95% of the time you're running without the ball. So it's our third corner kick this evening, fourth corner kick actually for the Zebras. So see what we get here. Great bending ball inside.
Oh, dangerous.
Jonathan Baker just misses it on the outside.
Oh,
great,
what an
dangerous
opportunity
ball
there. The keeper was well out of the goal box there.
Yeah, just mistimed that kick, and that's, you know, when it comes over there, kind of spinning funny like that, if you've got time to knock that ball down and then, you know, one time it off that bounce instead of trying to plant it off the bounce coming to you, that's a tough, tough shot to take, you know, coming spinning off the head like that.
Defense is doing a better job of getting to the ball quickly. Just seems like we're still struggling with getting it settled.
Yeah, well, we're getting this time of day now that, you know, our shadows are getting longer, but, you know, that there's that crisp, cool air, and there's, you know, some moisture starting. I would imagine starting to settle on the field just a little bit. You know, it's going to cause steps to be mistimed, and you're going to, you know, the ball's going to skip. It's not going to play cleanly. It's going to come off your foot a little bit differently than what it normally does because it's wet. It's damp. But if you look at strategies here, you know, Cassidy the night was just trying to chip the ball up and run and go to it. You know, and Peru's doing a great job of you know, playing it through the space and then out sprinting our guys in the back into that area. So it's something we're going to have to adjust to. And that's why we talked about marking our guy up. Somebody should always be, you know, on their two center mids up front, those two strikers coming through those areas. About 10 minutes left here in the first half here at Peru High School. We're in the boys' soccer sectional finals. The Zebras are trailing 2-0 to the Peru Tigers. So a little work to do here before half.
Another Zebra substitution. We've got A.J. Knotts and Jace Bixler back in the game.
10 minutes. 10 minutes left in the first half of play.
Good ball possession. Good ball control. Just missed time by Killian there. And that's what we're looking at, that defensive pressure. Denville Mason starts that turn, that possession, and forces a turnover.
Push it.
Switching fields. You know, it's something too that you've seen, you know, they'll talk about, you know, switch the field of play, you know, or switch it over. And that's, you know, we're talking about it coming from the left-hand side of the field into the middle and then pushing it over to the right, making the defense shift to make them change their shape, excuse me, and reacting and seeing if they can't cover the space. A lot of times you can slip somebody in the back door or the back side of it there. They get unmarked or forgotten about back there, and you can push it over, and you get a one-on-one situation or a one-on-two, and you get a shot off. Yeah. Good ball by Zach Du Bois to feed it out to that wing. Just a little off time on the run there. There we go. Good decision by to let that go out of bounds to kind of get the angle on the throw in. Good throw in. Good change of field. See if Jace can do something with it. Playing it to the flag. Good ball.
That was one of those balls that just had a funky spin on it, didn't it? How on earth did it stay in bounds?
Oh.
So who's at fault on this call?
Okay, so that's a good question. You know, the offensive player was in the air, but it's, you know, in any sport, once you leave the ground, you lose that space of verticality. And so you lose that position of the field. You know, and he wasn't an undercut. He left the ground, didn't have a clean play on the ball, and so it's dangerous. They called it a dangerous play. If he had bodied up and was, you know, back-to-back with the defender down there, then it's going to be, you know, in our favor. Or it's going to be a 50-50 call, and that's when they get the push and the shove into established position. But as soon as an offensive player leaves the ground to go up for it, they've got that space of verticality that they're allowed to play in, and he crossed over in the defender. The defender has that area. Just as if an offensive player or standing a defensive player jumps up into his space, you know, and falls on him. He can cross over, but if there's a violation or a foul committed, then that's when it's going to happen. So that's why you saw that foul on Peru and not on Rochester. And it looked rough. It looked aggressive. But, you know, it was a foul the other way. Good possession. Just mistimed it. Mistiming. Mm. You got to talk, guys. Got to talk.
Miscommunication there.
Good possession. Here we go. Much better ball possession. There we go. And that's where that communication comes into it. You know, as he's turning over, you know, he's got to be yelling or getting the head up and looking, you know, saying, hey, Chris, you got to take off, you know, or playing it through the space. That way he knows that it's coming to him before it gets there. And handball. Bad bounce. It happens, but
yep.
It's okay.
You just can't avoid it sometimes.
You know, sometimes those fouls are not bad fouls because it kind of kills the momentum.
Yes.
It allows the defense to reset. Taylor Medina coming out for a save.
Oh, ouch.
Stop. Oh, not you.
Jace Bixler taking one right to the kisser.
Yeah, I think he's a little stunned there.
Yeah.
Right to the face. But that's just one of those, you know, crazy balls. You know, the official's doing a good job of checking on him. He might have some blood or have some issues on that one.
Ouch. Makes my nose hurt just watching it.
Yeah. And it happened so quick. The ball came off the foot and just was at the wrong place. Just at the wrong place at the wrong time. coming through there. So hopefully Jace will be okay, and we'll see him in the second half. I think overall, though, you know, this first half of play has been played very cleanly. Just aggressive play. It's been clean play. Just, you know, kids trying to make possessions. Okay, so now situation. He calls the call. Check on a player. Ball is in no one's possession, so they're probably going to go. Oh, he's going to say that. Okay. If Peru had it. So what you just saw was at soccer, you see it, just a great sportsmanship play. It was Peru's ball, but to show that, you know, no harm intent, playing it back and kind of resetting the field of play and playing on instead of trying to gain an advantage there. So that was really just a sportsmanship play. It's nothing in the rule book that you got to kick it back there to the keeper. That's just a great sportsmanship play on Peru's half, just to kind of reset the field and you know, play it.
Kind of a do-over.
Yeah, kind of a do-over. Just saying, hey, you know, it happened. You know, respect you guys. We're just going to play it to you and let this play on.
I suppose it'd be a little more heated if someone had a clear advantage, you know, clear possession of the ball at the time of the injury.
Yeah, that or, you know, a lot of times what they'll do there is they'll just have a drop ball. They'll bring a player from both teams up. They'll just drop it, and it's kind of like hockey. You know, icing is called to drop it, and they just, whoever wins it goes on with it. So four and a half minutes left here in the first half. Rochester trailing Peru 2-0. Peru now on the attack again. Rochester controlled most of this half, but early on, Peru jumped on a couple quick balls, mistimed some possessions, and Peru capitalized on those. We'll talk about the shot charts and scoring run down here at halftime. But my shot tally, and that's how you score those, is a shot on goal is one that would actually be one that would go in the goal if the keeper wasn't there, even if it's a dangerous played ball. Okay, like that one there. Taylor may come out and get that. It's going to be wide past the pipes. It's not going to go in, so it may be a shot, but it's if you're a true soccer aficionado and looking at how things are scored, shots on goal is what you really want to look at, how you want to score the first half of whether you had good possessions and good shots at it. You can have 25 or 30 shots towards the goal, but you may only have three of them on goal that would count in. So
we've got a Peru corner kick right here, and a lot of zebra defense in there.
Rochester's pulled back everybody but one. Good stop. We talked about in the first part, you asked about, how do you play a corner kick? Well, defensively, you've got the keeper. He's going to play in between the pipes, and then usually you put a defender on each of the posts, because a lot of teams will get really good at sneaking one right around there. So Zach DuBois shot wide of the goal.
Wide.
Zach DuBois, great speed, great shot.
That they'll put a guy on each of the posts to protect that ball just kind of curving around. I know that we had a kid that I played with. He was left-footed, and he could curve a ball right around either the inside or the backside post just with the spin and rotation of the soccer ball. So we always had defenders on each of the posts to make that post wider, deflect that ball out, and then you also had defenders coming off to clean up a dangerous ball on each one of those markers.
Some good ball movement there.
Okay.
Two minutes left
on
first half of play.
Kellen shot just wide over the top.
Over the top.
And that's what we talked about right there. Is we have had two shots towards the goal, but Zach DuBois's were wide. So if the keeper wasn't there, it wouldn't have mattered because it went wide, and Killian's went over the top of the pipe. So it will be shots, but not shots on goal. Shots on goal right now, we are actually leading the category 3-2, but it's Peru's efficiency by putting in those two shots that they've had on goal to take that 2-0 lead right now. About a minute and a half remaining in this first half. Rochester has been controlling a majority of the half, but Peru has had their moments, but they've capitalized on two great possessions that they've had here in this first half so far. Oh, line. Ball broke the plane of the line. So it'd be zebra throw in.
60 seconds of play in the first half. Push it.
There you go.
See how Chris runs the outside, forcing the ball back to the middle where his strikers and helps that. That's what you teach your guys up front to do, is to bring those guys up and force the ball in. Defensively, you want to turn the ball to the outside and keep it away from that area. Just really impressed with the way that Killian Bailey has controlled that center midfield. Just distributing, collecting balls, pushing him out there to the wing. Nice thing is he's a sophomore, so Coach Brown's got two more years to enjoy him in the middle of that field, and hopefully another game or two in this season. All right, that is the first half of soccer here at Bingo Memorial Stadium here in Peru, Indiana. Rochester Zebras are trailing the Peru Tigers 2-0. We've got a 10-minute halftime here, and we'll be back to action.
So, Coach, leading us into the second half, what would you say the strategy talk was at halftime?
You know, for the Rochester Zebras. I know that Coach Brown, in our talking with his guys, listen, we're doing good things. We're getting dangerous balls. We're controlling the center midfield. We're getting our opportunities to put something through. We've got to be patient. They can't start pressing. They can't play out of control. They've got to play within themselves and keep doing what they've been doing all year. You know, attacking the wings, controlling the center mid, winning the 50-50 balls out of the air. Making sure that the defense locks it down, controlling those dangerous balls, pushing them to the outside, you know, and then just put a shot on the pipes, you know, between the pipes. It's going to go in. They just got to keep that pressure up. You know, if I think you switch to the other side and you Peru, they've got to continue to press. If they were able to get a quick goal here, you know, I know being up 2-0, you're telling them out, if you can come out and we can jump on them and get one more goal early in the second half to put them down 3-0 mentally, it just really puts a team in a tough situation, no matter how many seniors or how much leadership you have. So I know that Peru's going to continue to push. They've got to, you know, pressure the ball every chance that they have, not commit and overcommit to that. And where are they going to give up a goal? Because one goal here, either way, is either going to, you know, put somebody in the driver's seat or make this a very tightly contested contest. So I would imagine the second half coming out, you know, from both teams, you're going to see both teams press really hard these first 5-10 minutes of the second half, trying to either get a goal to push that goal to three, that lead to three, or that goal to really tighten up play here in the second half.
And Honeyager, turn the paper for the Tigers, get ready to send it deep.
The thing about a new half is that it's a 0-0 score.
It is 0-0. Bad thing about the half is it's still 2-0.
Yeah.
So we've got to get a goal. So hopefully that equalizer, not equalizer, that goal just to give us some momentum. 2-0 is still closely contested, but you just like, just as a championship game, as far as a fan's aspect, you know, you'd like to see that, you know, a 2-1 or, mm-hmm. or 2-2, just to make the kids, you know, decide that, you know. And I think that the first half has been well officiated. It's been consistent. The officials called, you know, the same thing on both ends of the field with it, you know. But I've been very impressed with, you know, the sportsmanship on both sides.
Yes, absolutely.
Of the ball. Peru Rochester is a long-time rival, goes back many years to two communities, you know, just down the road on 31 rivalry. But, you know, as highly contested as it is, the rivalry between the two schools, Peru joining the TRC conference next year, and this will be a conference game. It's good to see that, you know, there's still that sportsmanship element.
Yeah.
There.
Yeah.
You know, and that speaks volumes to the coaches on both sides, you know, on how they conduct themselves, you know, how they conduct their kids and what they expect from them, you know, on the field. You know, it's a sectional championship. Winner goes on to the regionals next weekend, and you know, the loser goes home for the year, and no one really wants to go home.
No.
At this point.
Got some kind of a personal foul there. Looks like it was on Rochester, on Whitfield.
A push from behind knocks the Peru player down. Good, dangerous ball.
Nice.
And there, just
play.
Mistimed it.
Wow, that was nicely played.
It was. You know, and I think another thing, too, is if on a goal kick, if a keeper can reset that, you know, and get that back in while either the opposing team is transitioning back into a defensive mode, you sometimes can get a cheap one on them. Mm-hmm. You know, it's that transition. We always talk about that transition element, no matter, you know, what sport you play, transitioning from defense to offense or offense to defense. If a team does not do that well, they will struggle. And especially in soccer, with the error margin being so small sometimes, that quick restart, the quick ball in on a throw in or off of a goal kick, sometimes can catch people sleeping and not being paying attention, and you can get a goal. So that's something that, you know, just picking up the speed of play in the second half is going to be very important for Rochester to try and get that goal.
You know, as you said there about quick restarts and things on the dead balls, we've seen a lot of these throw-ins come in very quickly, and some of Taylor's returns as well have been very, very quick. In fact, at the beginning of the game, it hit some kids in the back of the head because he just launched it right away, you know, trying to gain that advantage and take him off guard a little bit.
Yeah, and that's...
Is that a dangerous...
High kick. They just called a high kick. We were discussing that here the other day, that they don't call them anymore. Huh? They call them. They call them.
they call them.
Yes, they do. It was the right call. I mean, the foot was above. He put it above the shoulders, and it was at the defender with the cleat up. You know, it's a dangerous ball. Those cleats move, you know, just a few inches either way, and then you've got cleats to the face, and you've got a player injured. It wasn't intentional. It was just how Caleb played.
Doesn't hurt that Caleb's almost 7 foot tall, and when yeah. he picks his leg up, it's at someone's eye level.
He's a tall wing out there. So his long legs give him sometimes a disadvantage in some of those balls because his legs go so high. I think you're starting to see Rochester really press the issue here and start to put the pressure on Peru, trying to put one through. Killian Bailey is doing a great job of controlling that ball in the center mid. We got to get our strikers to run through that space, though. Gammy hanging back. We had everybody watching, and the keeper came out. And then, you know, if you want to make something happen up front as a striker, and that's your job, is to create chaos on the defensive end. We've got to have guys gunning through those gaps and those spaces.
And on that play in particular, had the keeper not come out, Jonathan Baker was right there ready to strike.
He was. I think he's got to realize, though, that as the ball's played in that space, he has to run through that gap and, you know, collect that ball and make something happen instead of waiting. We all do it, you know, with anything in life. We sit and we watch and we wait for it to come to us. And then what you got to do is train yourself to move to the ball and into those spaces and create opportunities to score.
And an element of timing goes into that as well.
Sure, it is. It's in a space. It's a timing element. Good throw in. Caleb's throw-ins sometimes are almost like corner kicks.
Mm-hmm.
He has so much distance to him.
Rochester's doing a good job of maintaining possession in the second half.
Yeah, you know, right there is what you like to see. You know, as a coach, as somebody that's possessing that center mid, is, you know, Killian just saw that little overlapping run, and that's the run that you don't see with, you know, all the time. It's just a little heel flick, and just nice and soft to it. You know that he's practiced that and worked on it. It's something you don't just watch on TV and go out and try. You're going to decide to do with it. So, you know, just good ball possession. Just waited and possessed the ball and waited for something to open up for him. Okay. Yep. Still a little overzealous there on the contact, trying to gain an advantage. Jonathan trying to get into the space there. I think he lost a height disadvantage there. Just trying to gain his momentum, his footing. Seven minutes gone here in the second half of the Peru sectional finals, boys championship game between Rochester and the Peru Tigers. Still 2-0 in favor of Peru. Rochester, though, is doing an excellent job of picking the pressure up and putting pressure on it. We just have not created anything offensively to get one to go through.
Oh. Now, who's the foul on there? There's a lot of arm locking there.
Well, he reached over. Denville Mason with the yellow card. And that's if his arms are down, it's just a foul. But the arms came up. He reached over the defender to try to gain an advantage and pulled him down. So just and it's good that that's called, because if they call that now, it's going to clean up a lot of extracurricular activities that's going to go on later on the game. And that it's going to pick up each, you know, 5-10 minutes that click off that clock is going to cause, you know, a little bit more aggression. It's going to be a little more physical, and it's good the official called that just to clean it up, whether it's on, you know, on us or on Rochester or on Peru.
We've got Zach Agnew coming in the game for Denville Mason.
And that's just, you know, composure.
It's a good move by Coach. Is that a mandatory thing? If you get yellow card, you have to sub?
Nathan Rabajewski set up.
Well, didn't used to be, but I think that may have changed that rule now to pull them out, that if you're carded, it's a foul, it's an infraction, you got to take them off.
I mean, a lot of coaches do, just because it's,
right,
you know, a way to get your player calmed down and maintain composure, right, or regain composure. But I didn't know if that was a rule that you had to.
Yeah, and they've also got, you know, they've got soft reds and hard reds now. Just the difference between those two there. A soft red would be after you've accumulated, you know, two yellow card infractions on the field where you've been carded twice. So it's a soft red. You can play the next game. A hard red, you are out.
Yeah.
Was that offsides?
Yep. Got a flag on the sideline. Looks like Rochester was offsides.
The center official can choose to stop the ball and play the foul, or he can choose to wave it off and just let the field of play continue on. And there was no advantage gained by the offense, so he chose to ignore the foul on the flag, waved it down, and just to let the play go on. It just keeps the pace, the flow of the game going well, which is a good call by the official. And if you want to watch that last play develop, that was really close on whether it was on or off sides. And that's just a matter of, was he there before or after the ball was played? And that's the misconception. You have to be even with the defender before the ball is played. You can run into space after the ball's played and be the only one standing there, but you have to be even with the guy, last defender, before you play into the space. If not, you're cherry picking.
Goal kick coming up. Simon Oberdorfer sending it back for the Tigers. That's my wife. I'm not here.
Keegan, hurry up. Nice to get ball. Got to win the middle, guys. There's nobody in the middle. Where are you at?
There's Killian again.
Mm-hmm.
Just seems to be in the right places at the right times.
Yeah. But if you look at the field of play go, you've got, eight guys in the back, or you've got four up front and the rest of them in the back. There's not that center pressure from Peru. And that's something they need to find that guy to come in and can help challenge that center mid. Killian, again, is out there all by himself in the middle with no Peru player in that space. And that's something you want to control with it. But, give Peru credit. They've really bottled Zach DuBois up, our leading scorer this year for the Zebras. He's got 20 goals after Wednesday's game, on the season. But if you take a look at these two programs and the direction that they're going, Peru's another successful winning season with it. This is Coach Brown's eighth year as the Zebra head coach with it. His current record is 62-58-20 on that. But I think you kind of look at his tenure in a couple different possessions.
Oh.
Outside the box. And that's that human element of where the foul happened. He's saying it happened right. Usually they put it right on the line. But he's moved him back a yard off of that. So it's going to be a direct kick by the Zebras. But if you look at Coach Brown's tenure, the first four years, the Zebras were 20-39-10 under Coach Brown's leadership. And the last 4 years under Coach Brown's leadership, they've been 42-19-10.
Wow.
So, once he was able to get into his youth programs and kind of establish, what he wanted to do and build, you saw, what happens after the fifth year. After his fifth year, they really started to turn around. The last 3 years, they've been 11-6-2, and 0-12, and 13, they were 11-4-4, and this year they're 14-2. So I think you're seeing, Coach Brown's influence on the program and that development, of a program all the way through.
Nice throw in there.
Ball's wide. Jay Spixler maybe have a chance to chip it in. Nice, dangerous ball. Right to the keeper by Zach DuBois.
Nice shot on goal there. Those headers can be so dangerous because you don't know which way they're going to go.
Yeah. It's the side of the head flicked towards to the goal.
How many times have we seen those win a game through the years?
Oh, especially off of a corner kick late in the game when it's 2-1 or 1-0 or 2-2. You've seen those balls, just dangerous balls where you get that tall, lanky guy up in there in the middle. Okay.
Michael Whitfield with the stop.
That's the disadvantage of playing a soccer game on a football field. Usually there's five yards wider than a football field. So you lose that space. You know, if you look at the markers out here, you've got, you know, the white football hash marks on the field. Traditional soccer field, you've got 10 yards wider on there. So that's on the length, on the width of it, I'm sorry. So it just mistimes your runs. Your spacing is not as crisp, you know, so. You know, there's another good question I've had is, you know, why would the keeper come out and save that? Why didn't he just let that go out of bounds and then make it a goal kick? Well, you know, it might have deflected off of one of our guys coming through the space, but he's also trying to save that from a goal kick because he can catch it, pick it up, and then he can move it out and kick it anywhere he wants to on the field. So that's just an aggressive play by the keeper to control the ball, save a goal kick where it may be muffed back in there, and maybe a chance it's even a corner. As it looked from our angle, it might have deflected off one of our guys' shins and been headed out. So it's just a good heady play by keeper in our transition. Good little give and go action in the middle. Ball's a little off time there. Okay, so that's what he calls play on. At that point, Peru had an advantage, you know, and once the ball bounced up to the place and they lost that advantage, he brought the ball back and then called the foul. So it's a little difference in how those are called.
Oh, Taylor coming out to save that one.
And that's what we've seen out of Taylor Medina, and I think if he plays that, like in the first half, that direct kick we had where Peru scores in the first one, I think that gets cleaned up. He's just a little nerves, not wanting to be overzealous with his aggressiveness, but you're seeing him now just, you know, play, and that's what they're doing.
Some substitutions here. We've got number 12 for Peru, Step. And it looks like we have Aaron Orr and Caleb Hunter coming back in for the Zebras.
Okay. Coach Brown waited a little bit longer than he normally does to start his sub rotation, but I think he's looking for somebody to maybe punch through and get that equalizer, you know, coming through. But fresh legs with Aaron Orr coming in. You know, Caleb Hunter's had a rest to come back in and let him run this wing.
We've got a lot of length on the wings with Caleb and Noah Roberts.
Yeah. Yep. And Tyler Gilbert, with his quickness on the other side, kind of balances everything out there on it. Bixler's back in the game, which is good to see after him getting, you know, hit in the face in the first half of the ball.
Stop and turn around for the Zebras.
To the flag. Good dangerous ball. Bixler out to run it down, just can't get control of it. 24 minutes left, we're about here in the second half, the Rochester Peru Boys Soccer Sectional Finals here in Bingle Memorial Stadium.
The Rochester continuing to have their presence there around the goal, trying to get a shot there.
Keep pushing, just Kevin got one to equalize there.
Oh,
off the post.
Just off the post there.
Noah Roberts,
Roberts
with the left foot.
Strong left-footed boot just off the left goal.
Good dangerous ball. It just seemed to be
nice
off that.
Nice throw
in. Little letter header flick in there.
And we've got a whistle.
Okay. We talked about that in the first half. Player leaves the ground. He loses his advantage, okay? They called it on. They've called both of those on the offensive players. A.J. Knott gets called for that one there. Jump straight up. If you're jumping straight up and your arms are down, not extending because they'll call a push there, you have that right to that space of verticality. Leans over and pushes, you know, creates the infraction, and that's why it's a direct kick going the other direction.
That seems like it would be something hard to break because just your natural reaction is to put your hands out to help stop yourself from falling down.
To fall down, so it means he's lost that advantage of verticality. If he's going straight up, you want him out wide, okay, for balance, but you also really want to keep him down if you're an offensive player so you don't get called for an infraction. Okay. Tyler Gilbert coming over to clean that up. That's what he's there for, you know. Grateful job of flicking that out, allowing our defense to get back, everyone to get in position, get our marks made out here in the field, you know, and reset our defense.
I wonder if the grass is starting to get a little slippery with some dew. We've seen a lot of slipping here.
You know, I think it is. If you watch the ball kind of skip and move around out there in the field, it's starting to, I think you're starting to see those things, you know, kind of take effect. And that also adds another element to it, you know, out there. The ball played back to a keeper, and that's why you continue to press and put that pressure on. That just the right ball, where that ball mistimes, skips funny off the grass, bounces funny off the keeper, off a defender right there. Mistimed it. Good play out to it. Okay, a way to use the keeper is just that extra release valve, and that's a lot of times they'll come out. Want that ball always played on the ground, though. I've seen guys flick it back to him, and they mistime it, and it goes over his head and rolls in. So that's something you have to work on in practice. It's something you can't just decide you're going to do in a game, because guys will play it back towards the goal, and I've seen them go in, or they just miscommunicate.
So we've got a lot of substitutions here for Rochester again. And I almost feel like this is kind of taking the wind out of our sails. We have our guy on the sideline ready to throw the ball in and keep play going before the defenders have reset. And then we have the substitution, and they're allowed to get to where they need to go.
Well, you sometimes think that, because I know the Coach Brown has told them he wants them to go to play fast, to play a little bit faster. But you also, you know, look at it. You get under the 30-minute mark, 25-minute mark, extends the arm, so that's where the foul happens. But you get past that 30-minute mark, you want to get some of your guys that do a lot of the running or has had a lot of the running, get them a quick blow. Give them maybe 5 minutes on the sideline, and then get them back in for that last, you know, 15, 20 minutes of this half to see, you know, what can happen. They should be in shape at this point in the season. And so it's just a matter of, you know, conditioning, getting yourself in the right space, and you know, utilizing your runs. So it does appear that way, that it's kind of taking the wind out of our sails, but, you know, it's substitutions, getting guys to come in and out, keeping legs fresh, giving them that maybe that rest that they need to get a quick drink, change a piece of gum, you know, in and out, and then get back in there and then just give it all they've got.
Doesn't look like we're shipping any balls to Abu Dhabi this week.
Nope, nope. Wednesday we had a couple of them airmailed by Taylor over there to shipping and receiving. So.
Oh.
Okay. So then there, I get the question too: is why was that not a foul? Well, the offensive player was creating space. Defender steps in. His first contact was with the ball. The offensive player hits the ball and then goes over it. So the defender is just an aggressive play. Offensive player is trying to make things happen. His momentum takes him forward. There's no foul. Everything was played. The ball was played first.
Take the ball away, guys. Come on.
Stand.
Hello.
Oh, just mistimed that pass up to Cameron Gask.
There's another example of keeping the ball on the line and in play.
Mm-hmm. Looked like it was going to go out. It doesn't. Okay, so we're going to have a direct kick about 25 yards out for the Zebras. Let's see if we overload this backside and make runs into the space. Get 10 yards. Now, the guy behind, he's got to be 10 yards as well.
Nicely
dangerous
played.
Ball.
Oh, keeper grabs it.
Defensive stop for the Tigers.
That was a well-placed ball.
Yeah.
Beautifully played shot by the Zebras.
Good save.
White ball. Two, 6, and 14 by them, maybe?
Yes.
Turn it. Oh, yeah, twist. Now shoot. Pop.
Look at it. Some good defense there by the Zebras.
So we got those subs coming back in that were subbed out about the 21, 22 mark.
Center official didn't see it, so they're going to wait another possession. Jeez. What a kick. Wow.
You like that.
Yeah, when Taylor's on it, he can really, you know, put the ball down the field. Oh, good try. You see these guys trying to, you know, save that, flick it in, make a dangerous ball, pulling it back to the middle of the field. 17 minutes remaining. Still Peru 2, Rochester nothing. We're going to need to get that equalizer here in the next few minutes just to give us a chance to have something here in the last, but still plenty of time. Just under 17 minutes to play. Get a goal now. It really takes less than, if you got less than 30 seconds, you can score pretty quick off of them if you just have the right sequence.
Yep. A little too aggressive there by Cameron Gast. We had a substitution there. We had Du Bois and Bailey and Bixler coming back in the game.
15-10-7. So far as strength goes, they're pretty much back to full strength. Their starters are on the field, ready to go.
Substitutions coming in for Peru, number 7, Braxton
Some
Campbell.
Peru substitutions.
Number 10, Brandon Simmons, number 15, David Tahan.
Campbell, Simmons, and Tahan.
That's okay. We can stay here 15 minutes. I'm cool. I'm good with that.
You notice a lot of the plays running through that center field through either Killian or Cameron Gast.
Yeah, they are. They've done a good job here. Second half, ball of a play to see if Caleb can get to it and send this back in. Oh, it's going to be a corner kick.
Corner kick
for the Zebras. Here's an opportunity.
Caleb Hunter setting up for the corner. Change that to Killian Bailey.
Got 7 Peru defenders there set up.
They've got them all back in there. Nice. Dangerous ball. Pack them in there, hoping that the
Jake Blair with the defensive stop for the Tigers at the goal.
Keeper got his hand on that and kind of pushed it out.
That's that communication thing where okay, we've got a foul on the other side of the field, so another opportunity here to create some offense. Looks like Killian's going to take this kick.
So in that case, when the Peru player has the ball and then the Rochester player is going for possession, can there be any offsides in that? Oh, my.
Oh.
Right there.
Wait, say that again, Allison. I missed that question.
Can there be any offsides when the Peru player has the ball and is driving back towards the goal and the Rochester player was right there and maybe slightly ahead of him? The Rochester player isn't receiving the pass from another offensive Rochester player, so there can't be any offsides there.
No, because you've got the ball, you've got a defender, and you've got the other player. So the ball is really the point at that point, because you've got two opposing players there together. Is you've got the situation. You get the ball, you get the last defender, and you've got the offensive player, all the elements to create it. So as they're battling for it, if the ball gets played off of the defender and the offensive player runs to it, then he's got that advantage. He's been played, so he can play through it. So there's no offensive,
no offsides.
Oh, man, good try.
Rochester creating plenty of opportunities here in these last 10 minutes of possession here in this half. Still 12 and a half to go in this game, but just get one to fall here, get into the back of the net, we would really tighten things up this last 10 minutes of the game. They've been really close the last couple of times down, just cannot find that elusive first goal of the game after scoring six against Caston the other night.
Nice.
50-50 ball. Peru wins it. Oh, right to our feet. We got lucky there. But I've really been impressed with our control, our passing, our spacing, you know, where our kids are at. We seemed just disjointed in the first half, where everybody was at. Our passes were not crisp. We didn't have guys moving the space. And that sense of urgency, you got that right now. That's what you're seeing from our guys. We're crisp because we know it's the last 11 minutes of the season right here. We've got to make something happen.
Caleb Hunter. Keeping possession for the Zebras.
Good
nice
ball in the middle.
In the middle.
Caleb Hunter, great.
Oh, just wide.
Outside.
Just wide.
Wow.
Good combination. Zach Du Bois is a little flick there from Jace Bixler, just left of the goal. Looked like from our angle it was going to go
sure
into the
did.
Corner.
Sure
I thought.
I couldn't figure out why
minutes,
the goalie wasn't moving over that way.
I know.
It'll be Rochester throw in. Very quick throw in.
Really? I wouldn't have thought that. Uh-oh.
Good setup.
Keegan Quinn, the defensive stop and kick out for the Tigers.
Okay, just with 10 minutes remaining in the game here. Rochester still trails 2-0. So the pressure is up. You can feel the intensity, electricity through the crowd down here. Rochester's really been pressing hard, but just cannot get it to go in. We've had great ball control. I've been really impressed with the way they've moved the ball and the way they've moved and attacked.
Oh, here we go.
The field of play.
You can definitely feel the urgency coming from the Zebra players. Nope.
Just off.
Just over the top.
You know, it's something that we, you know, have taught our kids through the year and found that, you know, if you're able to get a ball around the corner and attack the end line, a lot of guys will take it, you know, when they get to the six like there, they'll just take a shot. You know, and what we've always told our kids is when you get to that point, you need to stop and turn and play the ball back to the six, to the center of the six, where you would take a not a PK or towards the PK mark out there, because you should have strikers running through that area. And it's just a great little 1-2 combination timing. You know, if we could get our guys just to realize where they would turn, attack the inline. You know, Jonathan Baker's had a couple of those. Caleb Hunter's had a couple of those where they've played it through there, just haven't laid it back, where we've had two or three guys run into the space. Might have a better opportunity to score. And you're starting to see, though, these last 8 minutes, you got more of the Peru.
Wow.
You
know, they've been pretty
a lot
consistent
of
with those. There was a lot of contact there. I'm surprised there wasn't a whistle.
Well, and that's why I'm surprised that they had that PK early in the game, because it was a push. No one really had left their feet. It was kind of incidental contact, but they said the arm extended.
That's a very similar play there.
Like we have a card on the Rochester bench questioning whether that was a foul or was not a foul.
Let's get the rules.
So we got a stoppage of play here. 8:09 left in the game. I don't know if he's writing something down or explaining something over there. Coach Gonwer probably asking about a call or what's going on here situation. This is.
And there's the card.
First time I've seen in all my years of coaching that officials went over and actually grabbed the rules and showed it to a coach during the game.
So what is the penalty here? What happens?
There's no penalty on the coach. It's just a card. It's carded on the bench. If they get another card on the bench, then whatever coach that would have to leave the field. Should have to leave. So. So it's Rochester's pressing here. Hate to see that happen, but you don't know what was said. It's the heat of the moment out there. So,
like you said, a lot of electricity right now because we are down to the last 8 minutes of the game and down 2 goals.
Yeah. So yellow card on the bench. That's the second one on Rochester in the second half. I think that one was on Coach Gonwer over there. Questioning a call. It's going for a ball. It's one of those 50-50, and that's a human element. But see, if a linesman raises his flag and the center official doesn't, then they can confer and they can talk, or if the center official sees the violation, he can make the call. It's going to be Rochester throw-in to start play. 8:09 remaining. First yellow card of the second half was on Denville Mason.
Placed. And cleared by Peru. Taylor coming out. Wow.
Goalie to goalie, Medina to Honeyager.
Because he can. He's trying to get the ball down there first.
Yeah, he's trying to.
He can play, of course. I've seen keeper to keeper. It's been a while, and I've seen keeper to keeper on goal kick, or not goal kicks, but when they've collected them, where they've went clear bound, they've bounced, and then the keeper got it and kicked it back, and they've kind of played it back and forth. So handball.
Just out of high school.
In a high school game.
Really?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
I know we've seen it in the college ranks.
I've seen it happen several times at Argus, where it's been keeper to keeper, went back and forth a couple of times in a game, and just that strong on legs. Direct kick, flicking there by A.J. Knotts.
And. Goal, Rochester.
Goal for Rochester. 7:11 left.
Did not see who exactly got on that.
No.
Someone in there got on that ball.
Jace Bixler, maybe?
I would say either A.J. Knotts or Jace Bixler. They were both right there.
A.J. started the combination. I think Bixler gets the goal.
So goal and assist at least. And here we go.
Bixler?
Yeah. 7 minutes, 11 seconds left, and the Zebras are
72-49 in the contest is Rochester's first goal
of the
contest.
Suddenly, the Zebras are only down by one, and there's plenty of time. That lights a fire a little bit.
That changes things. Now we've got a 2-1 contest. It's the first time in 3 years that the Rochester Zebras have scored on Peru in the sectional finals. The last 2 years they've been shut out 1-0 in both those games. So this will change the complexity. Now what you're seeing is you're seeing the lead guy go over and check his linesman. I'm sure they're coordinating what time is actually left, but they're also coordinating whether there was no offsides on the call. I didn't see who it was because I was watching the linesman to make sure that there was no offsides. On the Zebras down there, because a lot of that chaos going on there. A lot of guys will get caught offsides. So this last 7 minutes, you're going to see a sporadic and an intense volley for Rochester trying to get that second goal to equalize this game, to send it into overtime. If it does go to overtime, we play two halves, and then we go to PKs to settle it. Short halves.
Short halves, right.
Short halves. 10 minutes.
We're right there, right
Caleb
there.
Hunter just Caleb wide, Hunter. Just wide of the bowl.
Wow.
Of the pole. They just missed the equalizer there with 6.5 to go. Still plenty of time. They're going to probably have anywhere from 8 to 10 more possessions where they're going to have probably a legit shot. Maybe they can get something on goal the way this pace is going and the way they're pressuring the ball.
I may have to stand up and start pacing again. I'm glad these cords are long.
Plenty of time. Plenty of time.
David Tahan back in for Peru.
Peru substitution. Number 15, Tahan.
Okay, just under 6 minutes remaining. Jonathan Baker streaking through.
And we had a whistle.
Okay, so what you've got there is Jonathan was in pursuit of the ball, and this happened here. He's been consistent, which is very good to see where a center official is. He lost advantage. No foul. The ball was cleared. We did not gain possession. So then it goes back to the spot of the foul because they did deem that there was a foul there.
Okay.
This is from the center official. The linesman did not have his flag up. So that's coming from the center official. On that call. So unless there was extracurriculars after that, but that would I would say that's what that was going to come back to, why there was a foul there and why it was so late being called.
Yeah, I mean,
it was several, 3-4, maybe even 5 seconds after the foul was committed
that
they called it.
I honestly didn't even see the center official call that because I had watched the ball go on and be played on.
Yeah, and that's a mark of a really quality official, you know, trying to, you know, give every chance he can to the offense to have their advantage of creating a scoring opportunity, and then if a violation happens or they gain or lose possession, that it goes back to the team that had possession of the ball where the foul was committed, spot of the foul. So that's where it was back there at that spot where Jonathan was at. So 4 minutes remaining. Rochester's pressing hard to try to get that equalizer goal. They have not let off a gas pedal here in the second half, and especially after this goal, to make it a 2-1 contest with 4 minutes remaining in this game.
Deshaun Whitfield sent it back for the Zebras.
Cool, guys.
Left to probably about maybe two, three really good possessions to make something happen.
Oh! Some rough contact there, but no call.
I mean, the official is going to do everything he can, you know, to let these guys on the field decide it. No foul. It's just an aggressive stop. Two knees together. That's when you get that stinging sensation. Then it's cold out there on top of it. Doesn't feel good. Yeah, stop the clock.
Do we have another player down?
Yep, got an injured player.
Okay, we've got a Peru player down.
Jake Blair, injured on the backside here, was down. Official stopped the clock to make sure he's attended to. He's okay.
It's here for Jake Blair. Chris Nance coming in to replace Jake.
Usually they allow each team a sub, so if the injured player subs, then they can obviously take him off, but then they give the opposing team the opportunity to sub if they choose to. They don't have to, but they have that opportunity to sub one, not many, but one.
And ordinarily you have to be in possession of the ball in order to sub?
Yeah, it would have to be a throw-in. And if it's not your throw-in and you're there to substitute, they usually don't let you cannot sub. But if you're there with somebody with the opposing team and they sub, then you have the same right to. But you have to have possession in order to sub.
The injured player is trying to return in, but is questioning the official.
No. If they take him off the field of play, he cannot come back in until time clicks off the clock.
And here
it goes. They're going to let him back on.
All right.
Okay, so no, time's went off the clock. So if you get injured, they stop it. They can leave you on. It's not like basketball. If you leave the floor, then you're gone. But as soon as the second ticks off, you can't re-enter the field. Yeah, okay. You can't do that. They took him off because of an injury. Time will stop because of an injury, and if he leaves the field to play, even with the clock stopped, he's got to leave now. He can report to the center, and then as soon as the ball's put back in play and they start the clock, then he can come back in. But yeah, it should not be allowed back on. If they stop the clock, he has to exit.
3 minutes left.
And there we see that sportsmanlike conduct again and playing the ball back to the keeper.
Playing it through just because of all the confusion and play through. Now he was.
Oh, now we've got contact. Oh!
All sides.
Yep. Nope. He had it up. He had his flag up.
He did have his flag up.
He had his flag up, and it was Jonathan Baker. Jonathan was on sides when the first ball was played. It deflects and comes back. He's now off sides, and the ball is played back up to him in that space, and now he's off sides. It was in playable position with it.
And they're going to discuss. Stop the clock.
See, if you watch the hand gestures, it's kind of what we're talking about. Jonathan was on sides when the first kick happened. Then it was deflected back. We play it again back up to him, and now he's in the offsides because he took off on his run. So he's in an offsides position. It's the right call. It's not the one we want to have, but it's the right call. Keeper stops moving. That's why he didn't move that ball. That's why that ball went in. Because it was not played to him. 2:23 left. It will be Peru's kick here on an offsides call, which offsides is an indirect kick. So this could not go in straight in on an offsides call, but it's one heck of a kick if it gets there. Emotions are running high.
Yes, they are.
We've got seniors that are going to play their last game. We've got sectional championship on the line. It would be third one in a row for Peru if they can pull this out. If Rochester can tie and somehow win in overtime, it would be their first one in program history.
Quick throw in by the Zebras.
Two minutes left in the contest.
Peru trying not to allow that corner kick.
Foul.
A foul on the Zebras.
One 40 left in regulation. Kicks it wide. It's not what you want to have if you're Peru. You want that ball in play and you want that in their possession.
Volleying, going back and forth there in the box, seeing if Rochester can come up with the ball. Looks like Peru gets it.
1 minute left. 1 minute left. This possession could be the one. Good clear ball back into Taylor Medina. That one would count if it would go in. Under a minute left.
Taylor playing way out.
Medina pulled from the goal. He's now just another field player out there in the field. If Peru can get it, they could chip it in and would go. Zach Du Bois.
Oh, Honeyager with another stop for Peru.
So close.
30 seconds left.
Seconds.
we have a whistle.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and there you go.
That's the ball game, ladies and gentlemen. Peru wins the Peru sectional, boys sectional finals. 2-1 over Rochester. Now that marks Rochester or Peru's third consecutive soccer sectional championship. So congratulations to the Peru Tigers. They move on to the regional. It comes back here next year or next weekend. Next weekend to Peru. They will find out later this evening who they will play. Unfortunately, the season comes to an end for the Rochester Zebras. Give us a moment here. We'll get the stats kind of finalized, and we will come back and give you a rundown of all the activities for tonight's contest.
First, number one, the senior, Denville Mason. Senior, Zach DeBoy. Senior, Christian Copeland. Senior, Noah Roberts. Senior, Caleb Hunter. Senior, Tyler Gilbert. Senior, Zach Admin. Senior, Josiah Cyber. Senior, goalie, outstanding, Taylor Medina. Rochester will miss these players next year. If maybe, some of them. Woo! Wow.
Okay, welcome back, Zebra fans. Just to wrap up the post game here, once again, Rochester falls to Peru this evening, 2-1 in the boys soccer sectional finals. Rochester ends their season at 14-3. Fabulous year for an outstanding bunch of young men. Peru improves their record to 13-5-1, advance on to the Peru regional here at Peru High School next week. Stats and things, just a few to run through. As we have it, Peru gets on the board like we talked about early on at the 226 mark with a goal by number 7, Campbell. And at the 5-minute mark, goal by number 1, Probajewski,
yes.
Breaks in on the scoring column, makes it 2 goals. And that's all the scoring that they have for the Peru Tigers, but that holds up. Then for the Rochester Zebras at the 77, no it wasn't. I had it written down here, just a second.
No.
Can't find it. At the, I believe it was the 69-51 mark.
Of the game ball to the runner-up.
Rochester breaks through with a goal by Jace Bixler. And then just couldn't find that equalizer. Final shot totals that I had, unofficial. I had Rochester for 6 shots on goal. Had Peru for 3, 4 saves, and corner kicks 5-2-2 in favor of the Zebras. They did everything they could tonight to get that win. Had outshot the Tigers. Had better ball control, I felt, you know, in the midfield of play, and just really did an outstanding job of giving themselves that opportunity. But early jitters, some miscues on defense, you know, ultimately is what did the Zebras in here this evening.
Absolutely.
So,
you know, the Zebra offense, got to give them credit, and the midfielders, Killian Bailey, did a fantastic job at the center field there, just really keeping a good hold on the ball and placing balls well to the front line to get those shots on goal, or those attempts anyway, and the Zebras never gave up. They just really gave it their all the whole game and kept penetrating and kept possession of that ball and just couldn't get it done.
Yeah, it was. You know, they've got a great group of seniors, you know, that they're going to lose, you know, off of this year's squad. Denville Mason, Zach DeBois, Chris Copeland.
Jonathan Baker's only.
Noah Roberts.
Junior, never mind.
Caleb Hunter, Tyler Gilbert, Zach Agnew, Josiah Seibert. and Taylor Medina back between the goals. So it's going to be a lot of holes to fill next year for Coach Brown and the Zebras. But the good thing is he's got a system going with his program. They're going to come back. It's going to sting for a while for him, but they'll regroup. They'll find the guys to fill in those gaps. Lots of positives to build from, from this season. Most wins in program history, and they'll be brighter days ahead for the Zebras.